Hello guys, let's start test series 3. First question is, in the Indian context, drain of wealth means foreign power in India squeezed Indian economy through various means and transferred it to their native country. This surplus capital caused industrial revolution in their country. Which of the following foreign ruling powers is associated with the above theory of drain of wealth? Option A, Aryans, option B, Turks, option B, Mughals, and option C, British. What do you think the answer is? So here, the answer is British. And drain of wealth theory was written by Dadabhai Nauroji in 1867, and he is also called the Grand Old Man of India. So option D is the correct answer. Second question, who from the following were associated with Subhash Chandra Bose, Indian National Army, and faced a trial in Delhi in 1945? P.K. Sahagal, B. G.S. Dhillon, okay, 3. Shahnawaz Khan, 4. Bhulabhai Desai. Which of the following are correct? Option A, 1, 3, 4, B, 1, 2, 3, C, 2 and 4, D, 1, 2, 3, 4. So here, the correct answer is option B, 1, 2 and 3, because Bhulabhai Desai was the known freedom fighter and as well as a lawyer. So he is not associated with Subhash Chandra Bose, Indian National Army. So 4 statement is wrong, so eliminate 4. So the option will be B, that is 1, 2 and 3 are correct. Now coming to the third question, whose book Unto This Last left a deep impact on Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, and he even translated it into Gujarati? Option A, John Ruskin, option B, Leo Tolstoy, C, Michael Madhusudan Dutt, C, Maxim Gorky. So the correct answer is option A, John Ruskin. Fourth question, in the early decades of 20th century, caste movement began to proliferate in the Indian society. Which of the following movements are related to caste consciousness leading to caste movements in particular region? So first is Satyashodhak Samaj in Maharashtra, second, self-sufficient respect agitation in Tamil Nadu, third, Gadar movement in Punjab, fourth is Bijolia movement in Rajasthan. Choose the correct code. Option A, 1, 2, option B, 1, 2, 3, 4, C, 2, 3, 4, and D, 3 and 4. So here, the correct answer is option A, 1 and 2, because Satyashodhak Samaj in Maharashtra was done by Jyoti Bhapule, and this is a caste movement. And next is self-respect agitation in Tamil Nadu was done by Erode Ventappa Ramaswamy. So he is commonly known as Periyar. Third is Gadar movement in Punjab. This is the people who are in Gadar party smuggled arms into India to use it against Britishers. So Hardayal, Sohan Singh Bakna were prominent leaders. Now here, fourth is Bijolia movement in Rajasthan. It is a peasant movement against excessive land revenue. So Sadhu Sitaram was the leader. So here, last two are not related to caste movements, whereas first two are related to caste movements. So 1 and 2, option A is the correct answer. Fifth question, choose the correct code. A correct answer relating to Supreme Court of India. Option A, the Supreme Court judge addresses his resignation to Chief Justice of India. Option B, Supreme Court does not have the power to review its own judgments. C, all civil and judicial authorities in India shall act in aid of Supreme Court. D, the Supreme Court has the autonomy to make rules for the practice and procedure of court. So here, the correct answer is option C, and Coming to option A, the Supreme Court judge addresses his resignation letter to the President, not Chief Justice of India. So option A is wrong. Coming to second, the Supreme Court does not have the power to review its own judgments. No, it is wrong. It has the power to review its own judgments. Okay, so option B is also wrong. Now coming to C, C is the correct answer. Now D is, the Supreme Court has the autonomy to make rules for the practice and procedure of court. See here, the Supreme Court with the approval of President can make rules for practice and procedure of court. It doesn't have any autonomy. Okay, coming to the next sixth question. The objectives specified in the preamble contain the basic structure of our constitution. In this regard, choose the correct answer. Option A, the idea of basic structure is explained in constitution passed on 26th January 1950. Option B, basic structure means that which cannot be amended in exercise of the power under Article 368 of Constitution. Option C, Parliament is the supreme authority on the basic structure of our Constitution. D, courts have no jurisdiction on basic structure of Indian Constitution. So here, the correct answer is option B. So let's see why the other options are wrong. First is, the idea of basic structure is explained in the constitution passed on 26th January 1950. No, it was explained in Keshavananda Bharati versus State of Kerala 1973. So option A will be the wrong answer because it is passed on 1973, Keshavananda Bharati versus State of Kerala. Now coming to here in B, Article 368 means the power of Parliament to amend the Constitution. Is it okay, guys? Now coming to C, Parliament is supreme authority on the basic structure of Constitution. It is not Parliament, it is judiciary. So option C will be wrong answer. Option D is, the courts have no jurisdiction on basic structure of Indian Constitution. No, the courts have legal power. Okay. So option D will also be wrong. The courts have legal jurisdiction on basic structure of Indian Constitution. It explains the themes of basic structure as per the situations and as per the cases they come with, they face with. Now coming to seventh question, estimates committee related to which reform to ensure the efficiency of the following? Option A, administrative reforms. B, financial control reforms. C, newly legislative reforms. And D, estimates for different program reforms. So here, the correct answer is option C, new legislation reforms. Here, the estimate committee means the committee which examines the estimates included in budget. Okay, so this estimates committee examines the written statement of costs including the budget presented in Parliament. So it deals with new legislation reforms. Now coming to eighth question, most important component of secularism are mentioned below except option A, equality incorporated in Article 14, B, prohibition against discrimination on grounds of religion, caste, etc. C, sentiments of majority of people towards cow and against its slaughter. D, not applicable to irreligious persons. So here the correct answer will be option D. It is not applicable to religious persons or citizens. And here option A, equality incorporated in Article 14. So this is included in secularism. Option B, prohibition against discrimination on ground of religion, caste, etc. is included. And also sentiments of the majority of people towards cow and against its slaughter is also included in secularism. What is secularism? treating all religions equal. So these are some of the important components, and the one which is not a component is option D, that is, it is not applicable to religious persons or citizens. This is not included in secularism components. Now coming to the ninth question, social justice enables a court to uphold legislation except option A, to remove economic inequalities, B, to provide decent standard of living to the working people, C, to protect the interests of weaker sections of the society, D, to enact unquestionable laws to protect certain people of the society. So here, the correct answer is option D, to enact unquestionable laws to protect certain people of the society. So what is social justice? Social justice means to remove economic inequalities, to provide decent standard of living to the working people, and to protect the interests of the weaker sections of the society. These are all included in the social justice. And what that is not included is to enact unquestionable laws. See, unquestionable laws means the people can't question upon the laws. So that does not come under social justice. That is, to enact questionable laws to protect certain people of the society will come under social justice. Here, unquestionable word is given. So option D will not be included in social justice. So option D is the correct answer. 10th question, a person who is free, who is from freedom. A person whose freedom of movement has been taken away by imprisonment or detention does not thereby lose his freedom of option A, expression, B, profession, C, employment, D, earning. See, you can easily answer this. Option A is the correct answer because this is included in one of the Article 19 of Fundamental Rights. If a person is in prison, he can't lose his basic fundamental right. Freedom of expression can't be taken away. So option A will be the correct answer. 11th question, regarding the habeas corpus, choose the wrong answer. Option A, habeas corpus safeguards the liberty not only of the citizens but also of the persons within the territory. B, writ of habeas corpus is not to be entertained when a person is committed to judicial custody or public custody by the competent court. C, a petition of habeas corpus lies against the executive authority, not available against the private individuals. D, the habeas corpus petition cannot be dismissed on the ground of imperfect pleading. So here, habeas corpus means it is a law that states that a person cannot be kept in prison unless they have first been brought before the court of law. I'll repeat it once again. Habeas corpus is a law that states that a person cannot be kept in prison unless they have first been brought before the court of law. So here the correct answer is option C. This is not included in the habeas corpus. So first, habeas corpus includes, it safeguards the liberty not only to the to the citizens but also to the persons within the territory. Option B is also correct because writ of habeas corpus is not to be entertained when a person is committed to judicial custody or public custody. Now, what is judicial custody? It is an accused is in custody of a concerned magistrate. So habeas corpus will not be entertained over here. Next, option C is not included in habeas corpus. Option D, the habeas corpus petition cannot be dismissed on the ground of imperfect pleading. This also is included. Now, the 11th question, wrong answer is option C. Option C is not included in habeas corpus. Now, coming to 12th question, regarding the directive principles of state policy, choose the correct answer. Option A, directive principles of state policy have been held to supplement fundamental rights in achieving a welfare state. Option B, Parliament cannot amend the fundamental rights for implementing directive principles of state policy. Option C, it shall be the duty of the state to apply these principles in making laws. Option D, directive principles of state policy do not confer any enforceable right and their alleged breach does not invalidate laws. So here, the correct answer is option D. We'll discuss about this question first. Here, the directive principles of state policy will come under part 4 of Constitution, and its main aim is to achieve a welfare state. And why is the reason directive principles is not judgeable? Because India needs lot of economy, and also people caste differences should be abolished, and there are many inequalities still in India where directive principles can't be overtaken without this without the inequalities arising. Okay, so if there is a caste movement, if there is a religious differences, if there is inequalities in different sectors like poverty and etc., so then directive principles can't be implemented. It includes uniform civil code, where when it is implemented in all over country, there will be a huge disputes. So for that reason, it is not judgeable and we can't approach court. But directive principles can be implemented in fundamental rights. Article 21A is one of the example, that is providing education to age group of 6 to 14 years. So this is also directive principles. So slowly they'll enact one by one. So coming to option A, so I'll tell the first answer. First is, it is option D will be the correct answer. Now we will discuss it. Option A, directive principles of state policy have helped to supplement fundamental rights in achieving a welfare state. Yes, this is the correct answer. This is right. Option B, Parliament cannot amend the fundamental rights for implementing directive principles of state policy. This is also correct. It can't amend fundamental rights. Option C, it shall be the duty of the state to apply these principles in making laws. Yes, it is also the duty of the Parliament to implement these laws by making an amendment. So here, Article 21A was added in fundamental rights, which is a part of directive principles of state policy under 86th Amendment Act. Is that clear, guys? I'll repeat it. Under 86th Amendment Act, Article 21A was added to fundamental rights, and it is a part of directive principles of state policy. Now coming to 13th question, regarding the governor, the following statements are correct except option A, governor is not answerable to either house of the state. B, governor is not answerable to either house of parliament. C, governor is not answerable to council of ministers. D, governor shall quit his office immediately after expiry of his term. Now the correct answer is option D. So now here we'll discuss the articles which come under governor is from Article 152 to Article 162. Is it clear, guys? From these articles, from 152 to 162, governor articles are present, and all the above statements are correct except this last one. Why? Because option D, the governor shall quit his office immediately after expiry of his term. No, he can continue until the next governor is appointed, and he can be for two or more states. 14th question, the orders passed by the governor of state fall in four categories. Find out the category which is not subject to judicial review. Option A, the exercise of executive power in accordance with the provisions of the Constitution by or under the order of governor. B, orders passed by governor on the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers headed by Chief Minister. Option C, orders like grant of pardon. Option D, where the governor acts without the aid and advice of the council of ministers and acts in his own discretion. So here, option D will be the correct answer, because there is no judicial review if the governor acts without the aid and advice of the council of ministers and acts in his own discretion. For this act, he will not be under judicial review, whereas the other three, that is option A, B and C, can be exercised a judicial review. So here option D will be the correct answer. Now coming to 15th question regarding the Union Council of Council of Ministers. Union Council or Council of Ministers, choose the wrong answer. Option A, a Council of Ministers must always exist to advise the President. B, even after dissolution of Lok Sabha, Council of Ministers exists to advise the President. C, even after the resignation of Prime Minister, Council of Ministers exists to advise the President. Option D, during the period of national emergency, the President acquires discretionary powers and can take independent decisions. So, which of the statements are wrong? Option D will be the wrong answer. So, we'll go to this. The Council of Ministers must always exist to advise the President is Article 74, Clause 1. So here the answer is option D. Now coming to 16th question, the preamble may be invoked to determine the ambit of option A, political welfare, B, people's demand, C, state's demand, and D, fundamental rights and directive principles. So here option D is a correct answer. The preamble may be invoked to determine the ambit of fundamental rights and directive principles. 17th question, regarding Article 15 of Constitution of India, find the wrong answer. Option A, Article 15 is limited to citizens only. B, Article 15 Clause 1 and Article 15 Clause 2 both are limited to discrimination on grounds of religion, place of birth, etc. Option C, Article 15 permits the state to make special provisions for women and children. Option D, Article 15 also permits the state to make any special provisions of SC, ST and socially and economically backward classes of citizens. So here, option C is a wrong answer. Sorry, here for 17th question, option C is a correct answer, because Article 15 is regarded to prohibition of discrimination on grounds of religion, race, caste, sex or place of birth. So here option C will be the wrong answer. Because Article 15 Clause 1 is the state shall not discriminate against any citizen on ground of religion, all these things. And Article 15 Clause 2 deals with no discrimination with respect to condition or restriction. So the next is 18th question, which of the following are not federal features of Indian Constitution? Option A, rigid constitution, B, bicameral legislature, C, independent judiciary, D, office of governor. So here, there are seven features of federal constitution. One is written constitution. Second is supremacy of constitution. Third is rigid constitution. Fourth is division of power. Fifth is independent judiciary. Sixth is bicameral legislature. And seventh is dual government polity. So these seven are the federal features of constitution. So rigid constitution is comes under federal feature, bicameral legislature comes under federal feature, and independent judiciary also comes under federal feature. So option D is the wrong answer. So this, as per this, option 18, option D is correct answer for question 18. Now 19th question, what options does the government exercise and legislatures have when they do not like the decision made by the Supreme Court? Option A, pass a law challenging the decision. B, pass a constitutional amendment that circumvents the decision. C, both the options, pass a constitutional amendment that circumvents the decision or pass a law challenging the decision. Option D, no options are there before the legislatures and executives. So here, option C is the correct answer. Now coming to 20, regarding the disagreement between the two houses of the state legislature, which of the following is correct? Option A, double ends and becomes dead. B, to resolve the issue, a joint sitting will be called. C, the only power of council is to interpose some delay in the passage of bill. D, legislative council is resolving body like Rajya Sabha. So here option C, that is the only power of council of ministers is to interpose some delay in the passage of bill. Twenty-first question, choose the correct answer from the following. Option A, a member of All India Service can be dismissed or removed only by the Union Government. Option B, a member of an All India Service can be dismissed or removed only by the state government if he is serving under the state. Option C, in India, state government's employees administer state laws only. Option D, the Union Government through its departments administers union laws. So here, option A is the correct answer. Now coming to 21st question, 22nd question, regarding the powers of president, which of the following are correct? Option A, no previous sanctions is required or recommendation of the president for introducing any legislation on any matter. Option B, courts are debarred from invalidating any legislation on the ground that the president's previous sanctions was not obtained. Option C, money bill can be returned for reconsideration. Option D, president does not have the power of disallowance of the bill of the state legislature, which may have been reserved for his consideration by the governor of state. So here, option B is the correct answer. The courts are debarred from invalidating any legislation on the ground that the president's previous sanctions was not obtained. Now match the following. Reprieve, respite, remission, commutation. The first one is reduce the amount of sentence without changing its character. Second is substitute one form of punishment to other for of a lighter character. Third, awarding lesser sentence. Fourth, a state of execution of sentence. So option A, 4312, B, 1234, C, 4231, and D, 3124. So here, reprieve, respite, remission, and commutation. So the correct answer for this is reprieve means to stay of a stay of execution of the sentence. Respite means awarding lesser sentence. Remission means to reduce the amount of sentence without changing its character. And commutation means substitute one form of punishment for others of a lighter character. So option A, that is 4312, is the correct answer. Now coming to 24th question, regarding the pardoning powers, choose the correct answer. Under the Indian Constitution, the pardoning power of President and Governor are one and the same. Option B, for offences made under the concurrent list without the state role, President alone has the pardoning power. Option C, the only authority of pardoning a sentence of death is President. Option D, as regards suspension, remission, the Governor does not have a concurrent jurisdiction with the President. See here, the correct answer is option C. The only authority for pardoning a sentence of death is the President. 25th question, sitting of Parliament can be terminated by adjournment, prorogation or dissolution. In this regard, choose the correct answer. Option A, adjournment terminates sitting as well as session of the House. B, adjournment all pending notices including introducing the lapse on prorogation. Option C, dissolution ends all business including bills and motions before Lok Sabha. D, adjournment sine die means terminating sitting for an indefinite period. So here, the correct answer is option D, adjournment sine die means terminating sitting for an indefinite period.